How's it? This is JP, mywayshiftreport.blogspot.com, and today I'm going to document my attempt number 23 at sap falling downwind. I did a similar video on attempt number 13 2 years ago. That means I didn't practice all that much, and you will see that I didn't prove all that much. I didn't prove them. And I will put the link to the video in the description of this video if you're on YouTube, and I also created a label on my blog that is GP's supporting downwind attempts, something like that. So I have quite a few things that that I learned that I want to share in all those attempts, and by any means I cannot consider an expert. The experts are the ones that actually can do the thing, but I just want to share the struggle and how hard it is, the difficulties that you will encounter if you want to try to do this discipline. Well, I'm going to start by saying that these days you can do a downwind with a wing, and that is a lot easier. It's kind of different though, because with the wing you can always, you know, power up and go to the next bump, so you don't really have that choice when you do the paddle. You got to paddle and pump and try to link and connect. But for sure, the more wing downwinds you do, the more that's gonna help a little bit with the skill of riding the box. The problem with the sap falling downwind is that there's two skills involved that are both really hard, and they have contrasting needs. I'm gonna be more clear. First, you gotta take off on nothing. And I say nothing because there are no braking waves out there. There is not bottom, it's open ocean, so it's completely different, way harder than on an even calf-high breaking wave on a shallow boat. You can't even compare really. So I've been struggling a lot trying to find out what's the easiest way of catching something. And I was lucky enough one day, I mean I kind of figured out by myself already, but I was lucky enough one day I paddled out. And who was sitting on his board in the middle of the channel, in the middle of the ocean there? Kai Lenny, waiting for his brother Rich to come by, because he said he launched earlier than him. And so, wow, boom, I sat next to him and I asked him as many questions as possible. Now imagine Kai Lenny enjoying his solitude in the middle of the ocean, being bothered by Uncle G asking questions. Now, it's super cool, and he told me that in order to catch a wave, or take off, let's put it like this, he doesn't even paddle, he doesn't do anything other than standing, waiting in surfer stance for the right opportunity. Which is the same conclusion as I have come to for myself. I wish I knew a little earlier. What is the right opportunity? So, there's no point of looking back or anywhere else. You want to be looking at the front of your board and the water in the maximum 2-3 feet in front of your board. Because whenever you see a little bit of steepness that it's slightly more than average, that's a good opportunity. It's actually a matter of feeling the energy of the bump. Again, you won't be seeing it, because when you turn around and you see a big bump, by the time it gets to the board, the big bump is gone. So it's useless. You gotta feel it, because they keep forming and deforming all the time. You gotta feel it hitting the tail of the board and kind of lifting the board, and that's a good sign that maybe something is good. And most times you don't catch that one, you catch the one behind, but at least you get ready. And then on the way down after the big one, if it gets steep enough, you paddle and pump like crazy, and hopefully the board will get up. So that's skill number one. Skill number two is, once you're up, immediately you want to go left or right and ride the bump. The problem is that riding a open ocean windswell bump is completely different than riding a breaking wave on a shallow bump. You can't unless it's shoulder high or more, you can't afford to go in front of the bump in the trough. You have to stay on top of the crest, which is something I usually try to avoid so far in the sap falling, unless it's really small. And now that I have the GLM 120, actually I'm changing completely my falling on broken waves and diverging. So back to the riding the bumps. will require learning how to ride the very weak energy that even, you know, big bumps in the middle of the ocean have, because they're fast, if they don't have a bottom, they're not throwing water. The problem is that unless you have someone towing you, you don't have, you have to learn to take off first, and then you can ride the bumps. So there are two skills that are key, but one you can learn only after you've done a good job on the first one. Now, to learn the first one, you want to have the biggest foilers possible. For the second one, the biggest foilers possible is not good, because once you're up, you have to be fast enough to kind of follow the bump. So I've been doing successful takeoffs, kind of half of the attempts, with the Maliko 280, which is probably the biggest foil in the world. But then it's too slow to follow the bump. And now I'm going to show you soon. I have a GL240 still from GoFoil. I'm borrowing it from Alex Aguero. Thank you, Alex. And that one, I take off a little harder than the 280, but then it's faster and I can move around a little more. The last attempt I did, maybe a month ago or something, I did the longest run. It was from Upper Bahia to Upper Baldwin. That is 0.8 miles I measured. I think I flew for 3-4 minutes. That was my longest run. Long or short, I come down all the times because of physical exhaustion. So a good fitness will help, especially the cardio and the lungs. And but that is because I'm poor at riding the bumps. If the better you get, the less you have to power and pump. So also there, it's something that eventually you will build and come there. But right now, at the end of every flight, I am exhausted. I come down, I gotta sit on the board at least 5 minutes with, yeah? And measuring my pressure, I go like 130, and I normally like 45. So I wanna come down, and then I'm ready to get up again, and just wait. I don't do anything with the paddle. So you wanna have the paddle already on the front side. There's no point at paddling on the backside, because if you paddle on the backside, I'm goofy, so I'm gonna go like this. If you paddle on the backside, whenever you feel that push or see that slope, it will be too late to switch and catch it on the front side. So I have the paddle on the front side, and I either paddle with the, you know, the stroke that goes from away from the board to close to the board to try to keep the angle, but the angle is key. Or, you know, I mean, to tell you the truth, most times I just drag the paddle in the water so that I keep the angle of the board in the right direction. And even though that means I'm pretty much standing still, almost, because the wind still kind of moves in the ocean, which doesn't help. You want to have a little momentum. It's the only way that I can have the board with the right angle. Right angle will be a little more over this side, so that when I feel that energy and I do the last couple of strokes, bam, bam, bang, and pump, the board doesn't yaw too much on the opposite side and I miss the bump. So that's where I have come so far. And if you notice, I have a little piece of paper with some notes that I took at home. I pretty much talk about this. I'm gonna, okay, so I'm gonna add. I would recommend you practice on short runs. Because one time, I do runs that are pretty short, they're like a couple of miles. And one time I got so excited, oh, I'm doing better with the 280, I'm gonna do all the way to the harbor. It was a mistake, because yeah, I was still doing like maximum 2 minutes, right? And the whole thing, elapsed of time, took me 2.5 hours. It took me a week to recover. The thing is extremely physically demanding and taxing. A paddle like this, my back shoulder is the one that takes the biggest toll. It's always sore, and this lat here, I gotta stretch like crazy after I do this. Also the leg, the front leg pulls the nose up with the strap. We're gonna talk about straps right now. So it's a demanding thing. If you go for a long run, you're dead day after. Ooh, the wind is kind of dying. Maybe I don't do it today, but I've been talking way too long. I should get into order later, but I also want to talk gear, yeah. So one thing that doesn't help in my attempts, let me see what am I, yep, is that I'm using my waveboard, so I'm not going to show it, to you. This is a lovely 5/8 Kalama, 28 and 3 quarters. I've been using this board for 2 years. I've tried smaller ones and I just love the extreme stability of this big board. Big or not, it still rips on the waves and I'm really happy with it. It's getting a little heavy, got water inside unfortunately, but anyways, that's what I have, that's what I use. As you can see, I have a front foot strap, which is kind of standard, meaning I use that on broken waves also. The back foot strap is a custom one that I fabricated, and as you can see, it's really long. So I'm gonna put, I can put the back foot here when I'm pumping to catch the wave, and as soon as I'm flying, if I need, I can slide back. Here it's not the same, of course, because it's a little loose, but at least I can use the foot strap when I'm trying to catch a wave. If the foot strap was here, which is where I have it when I subfoil surf, it would be too far back to take off. So some people don't use foot straps at all. There's many good downwind foilers that don't use any foot straps at all. I can mention my beautiful self again. I can mention Kailani, Zane, and Ryan Funk, and Jeremy Riggs, and Mark Raphorst. All these guys, they don't use foot straps at all. But they are much better than me at taking off and pumping and paddling. I might have spit on the lens. Sorry about that. And instead, I mean, without foot strap, I wouldn't take off once out there. So foot strap for me are kind of mandatory. And they just make taking off a lot easier because you can pull the nose up with the strap. And also for riding, I'm used to riding waves on a subfoil board with straps. If you put me on a bump, if you tow me on a bump without foot strap, I don't have the same control on the board. So I absolutely love foot straps, and I'm gonna use it. And I use it also for coil downwinders. One more detail. That is a 4 feet coiled leash. They make them for bodyboarders. I buy them and I replace the front cuff with a surfing leash cuff. And that is the best solution. I have the same on my wing, meaning the wingy thingy. And I like that length because like that, the leash is never in the water. And when I'm flying, the only thing, if I'm pumping, you will hear this, which is, you know, a little annoying sometimes, but it's better than having something dragging in the water. The other option would be the regular leash that it's long enough that you fold it and put it in your shorts. That one, you don't hear anything, but when you fall, and trust me, I do fall, then you get back on your board and you gotta put back in there, which I learned to do super quick. But in the middle of the ocean out there, it's just more convenient with the coiled leash. Let's talk foils. Right now I'm using, what am I using? The mast from GoFoil is 29.5. Obviously longer would help with the overfoils, meaning you would overfoil less, but it's more drag in the water and it wouldn't help the takeoff. As I was kind of saying before, everything that helps one part of the game seems to be a disadvantage in another part of the game, and vice versa. Same thing for the foil dimension. This one, as I was mentioning before, is a beautiful GL240, and right now it's the right compromise for me. I still need really big for taking off, and I hopefully at one point I'll be able to go smaller, maybe 210, and eventually one day 180, which is what most people are using, so that I can connect the bumps easier and go faster overall. But right now with the 180, I have very little chances of taking off. I'm still using the Maliko tail because that's what I have, and it's got plenty lift, even though it might be a little draggier than a flat tail. This was meant to be a brief introduction, and the rest of the video will be filmed out in the ocean, because with the GoPro mount in the wind, you know, you can't hear much. But unfortunately, as usual, I talk a lot, but I think everything I said was kind of important. So if you're interested in the topic, I hope you enjoyed. Next part of the video, I promise, will be more action in the water. Wish me luck.